I'm going to talk a little bit about some science that's coming back from the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter. We got some press this summer with the great solar eclipse that came across the continental United States. This is an image taken from lunar orbit with our high-resolution camera of the Earth, showing the eclipse near the point of greatest totality. So we got some press from that, and we want to talk about a little bit different type of eclipse that we get a little less coverage on, and that's lunar eclipses and why they're so special to lunar science. So an eclipse just means you're in shadow. Solar eclipse, you're in the shadow of the moon on a particular place on Earth. For lunar eclipse, you are in the shadow of the Earth, and the entire near side of the moon is in eclipse, is in shadow. And they progress in stages. The plot down here in the lower left-hand corner shows the two different types of eclipses. As you start to enter the Earth's shadow, you're in a penumbral eclipse. Once you enter the center part of the shadow, you enter the umbral eclipse and the total eclipse. Great thing about lunar eclipses, they can be seen anywhere on Earth that can see the moon, and they last a long duration. The total eclipses can be up to about 105, 106 minutes. Important to keep in mind, lunar eclipses always occur during the full moon, and lunar eclipses only affect the near side. So why are these eclipses special? Well, they give us a very rapid transition in temperature on the surface of the moon. And the surface of the moon has interesting thermophysical properties. The regolith, and we just heard from Amanda a few minutes ago, is this very powdery, dusty material, and it's in vacuum. So its thermophysical properties are very insulating. It basically is as insulating as aerogel, and it changes its temperature very rapidly. There's also rocks on the lunar surface, and they change their temperature more slowly. Because we're in this very short duration lack of sunlight, we get this quick thermal pulse, which allows us to investigate different levels within the in the soil as well. Whereas if you look at the entire rotational period in the moon, about 29 days, you're gaining a thermal pulse that goes down to about 30 centimeters. During the eclipse, it's just a couple centimeters. And so we can sense the upper part of the regolith and also smaller rocks than you can with the full day-night cycle. So we want to use this data to understand the structure of the very near surface, how fluffy it is, how rocky it is, and look at some different interesting lunar phenomenon and what their thermophysics can tell us about that. So LRO is in a great spot to view lunar eclipses. We're orbiting the moon, and so we can get very high-resolution data. And fortunately, LRO is also designed to survive lunar eclipses. So we have plenty of power to be active for most of them. We've been active for 5 of 7 of the total eclipses to date. Because we are so close, we can't view every area that's in eclipse. We're limited to a very narrow orbit tracks. And when we go over each of these areas, we basically get one orbit during the total eclipse, and then we'll get another orbit, which is either when you're entering or exiting the eclipse. And so we choose our observations very carefully based on what landforms are near the orbit tracks and what their thermophysical properties are. The map on the right is showing the rockiness or fluffiness of the surface. The instrument that we use during eclipses is the Diviner Lunar Radiometer. It's a temperature sensor. It has 9 spectral channels. 2 of them measure visible light, and 7 of them measure infrared light from the mid-infrared all the way out into the far infrared. And because we have these spectral channels, we're able to measure the full range of temperatures on the moon, which has the most extreme temperature variations of any place we know of. There's permanently shadowed regions near the poles that are as cold as 17 Kelvin that we've measured with Diviner, and then the equatorial regions can be up over 400 Kelvin. Important aspect of this is that Diviner can point independent of LRO. So LRO is at a very standard nadir pointing orientation to save heat and, to a lesser extent, power during eclipses, and we use Diviner to look off to the side, our own instrument. All right, so what do we see? I pulled out an example here. This is going over a relatively young lunar crater called Kepler Crater. So as we get into the eclipse, it's kind of mid-morning. It's daytime, surface is warm. We enter the penumbral eclipse, the partial shadow, and the surface starts to cool off. Once you're in the total eclipse, the surface cools off very rapidly. If you look at the scale bar, we've cooled off 200 Kelvin in these fluffy areas around the crater. In the crater itself, it's staying warmer because there are more rocks there. And that's one of the things we're looking at for this particular example is the distribution of small pebble-sized blocks. And then after the eclipse, the surface rapidly warms up again. Each one of these is 2 Earth hours apart, which would be nominally about 6 lunar minutes apart. And another interesting phenomenon we've been looking at are these thermal anomalies that were discovered by Josh Banfield a few years ago. Basically, every fresh impact crater on the moon disturbs an area of tens to up to about 80 crater diameter away that's really only visible in the thermal inertia maps. And so it's fluffed up this large area that extends around the small crater. And we've identified these by looking at the temperatures in the pre-dawn data. So right before dawn, this temperature difference is greatest for these disturbed areas. There are these colder blue lines. Typical regolith is this red line. But when we look at these areas in eclipse, they're actually warmer during the eclipse. And so that means although they have a fluffier structure generally, the very top part actually has to be less fluffy. And so we're trying to figure out exactly how that works for understanding that. All right, can start the plot on the left. These are actually Earth-based thermal telescope movies, and this plot here on the left is Kepler, and you're going to see something very similar to what we saw with the Diviner data. Rocks stay warm, regolith gets cooler. If you could start the one on the right as well. This is Reinier Gamma. This is a space weathering anomaly. It's an albedo anomaly. And here, we were looking to see if there were thermal physical differences. And once you get an eclipse, you see the feature just completely disappears and you see the background rocks. So here, we're using ground-based telescopes that were measured at the same time as the Diviner observations to get this higher temporal resolution. So there's a nice synergy between the two different types of observations. All right, so kind of in summary, we're getting really nice data from the lunar eclipses. We may not be able to do this very much longer going forward. LRO has been up there for over 8 years. Its batteries have degraded a little bit. And so we're at the point where total eclipses are probably off the table, but we're still going to look at partial eclipses. And we're also evaluating the data as we enter the eclipse and we exit the eclipse to get additional information as well. So with that, I'll take any questions. Thank you.